Leia here from leiafirstsci.com, and in this video, we'll do a quick introduction to alkyne reactions. Alkynes are very versatile when it comes to synthesis and retrosynthesis, so it's important to understand why and how they're reactive, and exactly what you can do with them. You can find this entire video series, along with my alkyne reactions practice quiz and cheat sheet, by visiting my website leiafirstsci.com/alkyne. Let's do a quick review. An alkyne is a molecule that has a carbon-to-carbon triple bond, which is written out as a carbon with three lines, but remember that the three bonds consist of one sigma and two pi bonds. The pi bonds exist in the Y or up and down plane, and the Z or forward and back plane. To have two pi bonds forming between the same two carbons, we have to combine one s and one p orbital to give us an sp hybrid, which means the molecule has a 180-degree bond angle. If we look at these two carbons, the gray line between them would represent the sigma bond. In the Y plane, we'll show the p orbital going up and down, and when these overlap, we get our first pi bond. In the Z plane, we'll show another p orbital, where the dark blue represents coming forward out of the page, and the light blue represents going back into the page. When these overlap, we get a pi bond in the Z plane. Carbon having four orbitals, saving the Y and Z p orbitals for pi bonds, we're left with just one s and one p that fuse together, making the alkyne an sp hybrid, making the alkyne a linear molecule with a 180-degree bond angle due to the sp hybridization. In line structure, you just draw a straight line and then the two additional bonds, remembering that this is one carbon and that's your second. To name an alkyne, you add Y-N-E to the end. For example, ethyne is the smallest alkyne and is simply H, C, triple bond, C with another H. The common name for ethyne is acetylene, and you do have to memorize this because it will show up over and over on your exams. For more in-depth review, make sure you watch the hybridization and naming videos linked below. But what makes the alkyne so exciting for reactions? The first is the fact that alkynes are acidic. A terminal alkyne is one that has the alkyne at the very end of the molecule, so that it ends with a hydrogen rather than this end, which has a carbon. This hydrogen here is fairly acidic, where acetylene, as we saw above, has a pKa of 25. The pKa changes slightly depending on what else is on the molecule, but 25 is that general range. It's not too acidic, but it's definitely acidic enough to participate in reactions. For example, in the presence of a strong base like NaNH2, where Na+ is a positive spectator, leaving us with the amide ion NH2-, the amide will reach out for and grab that terminal hydrogen, giving acetylene back its electrons and forming the acetylide anion, along with NH3 in solution. The acetylide is a good nucleophile and a key to your retrosynthesis arsenal because you can now use this for SN2 reactions and chain elongation. What else can we do with alkynes? Let's do a quick run through, and then we'll go into the individual reactions in the upcoming videos. If you're not given an alkyne, no problem, just make it. You can make alkynes from a vicinal or geminal dihalide. For example, here we have a geminal dibromide, and in the presence of a strong base, we get a double elimination, which gives us two pi bonds forming between these two carbons, for an alkyne. We can also start with a vicinal dihalide. In this case, we have chlorine on two neighboring carbons, and in the presence of a strong base, once again, will give us an alkyne. In upcoming videos, we'll look at why we need H3O+ when forming a terminal alkyne. Say we don't actually want the alkyne, but instead we want to use it as a stepping stone for other reactions. That's perfectly okay. We can reduce the alkyne if using H2 and a metal catalyst all the way down to the alkane, or stop at the alkene. Using H2 and a Lindlar's catalyst, we'll get a cis alkene. Using sodium or lithium in liquid ammonia for dissolving metal reduction, we'll get a trans alkene. And of course, we can use the alkyne as a jump-off point for adding functional groups to the molecules. For example, we can react it with HX or X2 for hydrohalogenation or halogenation. For example, using HCl or Br2. We can do a hydration reaction, which initially gives us an alcohol, but then through ketoenol tautomerization gives us a carbonyl. For example, if I use BH3 followed by H2O2 and NaOH, we'll get an enol at the anti-Markovnikov position that will immediately tautomerize to give us an aldehyde, or we can react it with HgSO4 in the presence of H2SO4 in water for an enol at the more substituted or Markovnikov position, but this too will tautomerize to give us a ketone. And let's not forget oxidative cleavage, where a couple of different options will give us two carboxylic acids breaking that triple bond in half. This video was a quick fly-through, hopefully to show you how exciting this is rather than make it overwhelming. And this will show you why it's such an important tool to have in your synthesis and retrosynthesis arsenal. Let's take a look at the remaining videos to break down each of the reactions to make sure you're crystal clear on what it is, how to do the mechanism, and when to use it. You can find this entire video series, along with the alkyne reactions, practice quiz, and cheat sheet by visiting my website, leahforsci.com/alkyne.